So I don't know if you've noticed, but I talk with my hands. And I don't just do it when I'm talking with other people. No, I do it when I'm talking on the phone, I do it when I'm talking to a camera, I even do it when I'm having a conversation with myself in my head. You know, I'm just walking around silently. You know, there's nobody there to hear it, and I'm not saying anything out loud, but you know, hands are still moving. Step one to looking like a crazy person. Gestures, tone, and body language are an important part of communication. They can completely change the meaning of the same phrase. So beyond their clear aid in transmitting a message, where might these gestures have come from evolutionarily? A recent study shows that they might have originated in the hindbrain of fish. Now, when many fish want to send an acoustic signal, they can do so by vibrating their swim bladder. However, some fish that don't have swim bladders, like the sculpin, can send acoustic signals by vibrating their pectoral girdle. A recent study showed that the area of the hindbrain from which these neurons originates is also the origin of neurons which control locomotion and non-vocal functions in the pectoral appendages. The researchers believe that this suggests an evolutionary history for our own coupling of vocal and pectoral movements, because, you know, our pectoral appendages are our arms in sort of four-limbed vertebrates like us, that began in the hindbrains of fish. Now, I read this article, but it didn't really satisfy all of my questions, so I tried to dig a little deeper. Now, the original PopSci article where I learned about this study linked to a different article from the late 90s, which looked at a study which looked at blind children, and it paired the children up and it had them talk to one another, and they found that even though neither of these children could see the gestures, they would both make them. Not only that, but they found that the gestures they made were similar in size and shape to the gestures made by their sighted counterparts. So this was really interesting that these children, who had never really had the opportunity to learn or copy these gestures from others, were still making them. So this was another interesting piece of the puzzle and suggested that you don't just watch somebody gesture and then gesture yourself. There's something different happening here. So I looked at another paper which showed that by the age of 3, children can pretty well comprehend the meaning behind co-speech gestures, and that sort of grasping of the concept behind a gesture increases with age. And there was another study which looked at teaching children math, and they found that children who were able to watch somebody gesture when they were learning performed better than children who didn't. And yet another study looked at similarly aged human children, chimps and bonobos, and found that in all 3, the use of gestures preceded the use of symbols, either words or images, and that as time increased, all 3 of them increased their ratio of symbol to gesture use. Now, because humans, chimps, and bonobos make up a clade, a group of animals with a common immediate ancestor, it indicates evolutionarily that that gesturing was probably also present in that immediate common ancestor. So gestures may have begun in fish, and blind children make them even though they've never seen them, and kids start to make them when they're very young, and they help them learn and sort of help them parse communication, and they're also shared among some of our closest evolutionary relatives. So we've got some clues as to what they are and where they came from, but we're still not entirely sure why I couldn't have a conversation if my hands were tied behind my back. So, just another question as you go forth and do science.